So the 90s, they were a weird time. We were making tough decisions between whether to go to college, use that money to buy Princess the Bear for $500,000. We were listening to the Macarena unironically, and the American Civil Liberties Union, or ACLU, was suing the government for the right to be profane and hateful on the internet. Wait, what? Yeah, it's weird. Just listen to their spokesman do a terrible job selling their victory on this. And quick spoiler alert for anyone who isn't sure whether you can legally post inappropriate things on the internet. Although, unless you just got out of a time capsule from the 80s, you probably already know the answer.
The ACLU recently won a case in which we declared unconstitutional a federal statute that would have made it a crime to engage in speech that is harmful to minors on the internet. We're very pleased by this result because we think Congress should not be in the business of censoring the internet.
That's right. An attorney named Chris Hansen took out internet child protection laws. Although, how much fun would To Catch a Redditor be? So, this was a massive victory for free speech online. But before we get into the case itself, let's get some background. In 1996, Bill Clinton signed into law the Telecommunications Act of 1996. That was a turducken of different acts, including the Communications Decency Act, which got shoved deep in there. So this Decency Act attempted to do two things: get rid of indecency and obscenity on the internet. Aw, in the 90s we hadn't yet realized that the internet was going to be 90% hate and porn, 9% search engines to get to the hate and porn you find most agreeable, oh, and 1% cats. Specifically, the act criminalized the intentional transmission of obscene or indecent messages, as well as the transmission of information which depicts or describes sexual or excretory activities or organs in a manner deemed offensive by community standards. Wow, if this stayed in law, it would have been a lot harder to report on the later years of the Clinton White House. The ACLU sued against this law, leading to the Supreme Court.
I was very much involved in the debate on the Communications Decency Act and found the argument today very interesting. I think we all need to understand that what you're talking about here is one of the great issues of constitutional law. I think the court did a good job of asking a bunch of questions about it, and I think once we hear from the court what they think the principles are that deal with this, we'll have the opportunity to write a better statute.
So, did the Supreme Court remove pornography from the internet? A feat I can only assume they would celebrate by sweeping sand off of all of the beaches. Or did the Supreme Court shoot it down? Join us as we walk down memory lane to a point where the government actually thought they could control the internet. In a Supreme Court case, that will have you all saying, "Wow, I don't remember the 90s being that 90s. So first, I did skip over a fair amount of this case because it was explaining the information superhighway to a bunch of people your grandparents' age back in 1997. Basically, if you don't know how the internet works, well, then I'm impressed you managed to find this video. First, what's the problem?
With as many as 8,000 sexually explicit sites on the World Wide Web alone at the time of the hearing, and the number estimated to double every 9 months, the internet threatens to render irrelevant all prior efforts to protect children from indecent material.
Oh man, get ready to hear people saying the World Wide Web a lot. Unfortunately, the internet has a ton of easily accessible porn on it, and, well, kids under 18 can get that. So the first major question here is, legally speaking, what is indecent speech? Because, well, it's different from obscenity, and it doesn't include patently illegal things like child porn, child stalking, and obscenity.
We're only talking about a much different subset of speech that is called patently offensive or indecent speech. I want to emphasize that that standard is broader than any standard this court has ever upheld, even with respect to sale or display directly to a minor, and is vastly broader than the standards applied in the 48 states, which use a harmful to minors standard, which requires that the speech be not only patently offensive for minors, but also appeal to a prurient interest for minors, and lack serious value.
This is where things get interesting, because this Supreme Court case might seem like a debate about protecting children, but it was really a debate about what the internet is. Because what the Clinton administration wanted to do was apply FCC standards to the internet. Not just no porn, no swearing, and no radical politics.
about SmokinHotDance.com.
See what happens next at GoDaddy.com.
Nope, you're gonna have to buy the Laserdisc. Now, there would be an adult section of the internet, but we'll get to that in a bit. The majority of the internet would be able to be about as raunchy as Nick at Night. And here's why. There was this argument that came and went pretty quickly, but it's crucial to understanding the government's logic here. When there was a debate about whether you could censor indecent speech with a minor present in a public space, which would make it so that every time my dad said a f*** to me before I was 18, I could have him held criminally liable, talk about a next level swear jar. Anyways, when faced with this question, the attorney advocating for decency on the internet said it would be harder. But why?
It's a harder case because a public park is it's a free space. It's an area where, unlike the internet, speech is free.
You're asking us to say that the internet is not a public forum.
The internet is, we don't think it is, but if it is, in any event, it certainly is, like other public forums, subject to reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions.
If you were to say that in 2018, that's a battling, or more likely a doxing. At the time, though, what was the internet? A public forum or a collection of websites where people occasionally uploaded something NSFW? So before we talk about why this is unconstitutional, let's talk about what it would have looked like. Because to reference the telecommunications mediums in this case that were mentioned, the internet would have functioned more like TV and radio than telephone. Basically, you'd have your public internet that read like Ned Flanders' blog, and then you would have the adult section, where you would have to prove you're over 18. And immediately, this is where things start to fall apart for a few reasons. Most importantly,
there are 40 million speakers who use newsgroups, listservs, and chatrooms. It's not technologically possible in those means of communication to screen for age. The government's expert conceded that. Mm-hmm. There are about 100,000 websites in all. And most speakers cannot afford the $1,000 to $10,000 it costs to have their own website.
All right, well that is the most 90s thing I've heard in a while. $10,000 to start a website? That's almost enough to get a Beanie Baby. So chat rooms, newsgroups, and listservs would all have to be censored because they can't screen for age. We're off to a great start for free speech. I mean, if you censor all message boards to the level of TV, then Red Pill White Guy Genocide 67, how will I know where you want me to stick my most recent episode? This censorship would have meant that all of these public conversations would have to be censored, leaving us with incredibly expensive to make websites. The biggest problem here is that
in newsgroups, chat rooms, and listservs, you are engaging in an interactive dialogue, a conversation in which you speak and the listeners reply, and you can reply to what they say. They can be outraged, they can be offended, they can have a good point to make. A website is static. What the government is saying is that the 40 million people who can speak in an interactive dialogue in the other modes of communication on the internet should post a static message on their website. And maybe the people who were in the news group would come to see it, maybe not. But the speaker would not get any feedback, there'd be no dialogue.
You'd essentially have this gated off offensive part of the internet with comments disabled, so you might have more influence actually just yelling at your TV during the Super Bowl. Clearly, this is an especially big problem when you realize how hard it is to verify age. We're not talking about a check this box if you're over 18, which deters exactly nobody. We're talking real systems, mostly through
the principal way to screen for age is through use of a credit card. If you are not a commercial speaker, most credit card companies will not verify the credit card at all. Period. For any cost.
Yeah, so every time you want to watch free internet porn, just give that company your credit card and you're good to go. That sounds like a great idea. So that's a problem for quite a few reasons, more than you might imagine. First, no credit cards, sorry, but you're stuck with Barney's internet. I love you, you love me, or even books like Catcher in the Rye might have to be 18 plus in online libraries. More importantly though, this would mean that you could pretty much only have commercial websites or super rich people distributing offensive material. Because to get credit card verified, you either have to buy something or
most credit card companies simply will not verify for any price for a non-commercial transaction. They're not set up to do that. A few credit card companies will, but the record evidence showed they charge $1 per verification for a non-commercial verification. Now, if you're a speaker who wants to make your speech available to 100,000 listeners, that means you, the speaker, would have to pay $100,000 for the privilege of speaking.
Okay, seriously, how could anyone have thought this was a good idea? Simple. If you understand the internet about as well as someone in their 70s, in 1997, who's read more of the Constitution than Alta Vista, this argument might sound reasonable.
Well, what about the first radio people, you know, before the Federal Radio Act in 1927? I'm sure that imposed a lot of operating requirements on radio stations, and before that, they could just say, well, we like it the way it is. The government shouldn't have to tell us we've got to have all this equipment. But nonetheless, the government did tell them, and that's certainly been upheld.
Yeah, the internet could be like radio, if you view it as just a bunch of people posting things without actually paying attention to each other. Okay, that got a little too real. But real-time conversations and interactability set it apart. And hey, just in case you thought there was a little wiggle room for interpretation...
The conference report at page 188 and 189 makes very clear that Congress expressly rejected the more narrow, harmful to minors standard, which would require that the speech be not only patently offensive, but also appeal to prurience and lack serious value. Second, the conference report makes clear that Congress intended to apply the act under using the FCC broadcast standard for indecency that was at issue in the Pacifica case. As the FCC said in Pacifica, and as this court noted, under that standard, speech can be found indecent even if it is not prurient and even if it has serious value.
Wow, I have never heard Congress be so specific. Yeah, there is no room for interpretation there. So on to another huge sticking point.
Is it the case under those provisions that suppose a group of high school students decide to communicate across the internet and they want to tell each other about their sexual experiences, whether those are real or imagined? They're all, every high school student who would do this is then guilty of a federal crime and subject to 2 years in prison.
If high school, when you say they want to talk about their sexual experience.
That's been known to happen in high school.
It's funny because we could sentence high schoolers to 2 years in prison for being profane to each other on private or public forums. You get it? This led to a very long and very uncomfortable discussion over whether the law could be changed to allow parents, other students, or different people to send explicit things to minors. And I'll save you a bunch of time listening to uncomfortable jokes about Justice Scalia's kids by just playing this clip.
If high school students, like anybody else, communicates what a jury would find and what this court would establish given its responsibility to create a constitutional floor to be patently offensive within the meaning of this statute, they would violate it because the alternative...
There's no high school student exemption?
Justice Scalia, you may find it in the legislative history, but it is not apparent on the face of the statute.
Was it open mic night at the Supreme Court? Yeah, that's really not funny. Sorry, I mean, geez. So, no exceptions for anybody. If you post something that couldn't be said by SpongeBob or Joey from Friends on the internet in a place where it could see...
Goodbye.
One final problem here was that the entire system didn't work. They kept calling it the World Wide Web, but seemed to forget that the worldwide part. We could only apply these restrictions to US-based companies. So, while this might have led to those oddly sexual animes from Japan becoming popular in America a few years earlier, it might not have done much else.
The way the internet works, a child using a search engine can sit down at their typewriter and they type in, if they want to go somewhere, something like XXX sex. If that home computer is not using parental control software, that search engine will go out there in the world and list the XXX sites that are available. All the XXX sites that are foreign will be listed there. The kid then clicks the mouse and they have access to all the indecent speech they could possibly want to see. The government's interest here was not limiting children to 50 four-letter words a day instead of 100. The government's interest was protecting children from access to indecent speech at all. And this act will be completely ineffective in achieving that goal.
So what happened? I mean, you probably guessed, but the court voted unanimously that this act was unconstitutional. Moral of the story? Next time you want to post something hateful and laden with swear words and slurs on a public forum, just take a second to thank the American Civil Liberties Union first. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel by clicking on this logo floating to the right of my head. As always, thank you for watching, and remember to give me a